Good morning, everybody. I am so thrilled to be here for the second year in a row. That is such an honor to get to be here for a second year in a row. How many of you were here last year? Oh my gosh. Repeat offenders? Yeah? Partners in crime? Awesome. Well, I'm thrilled that you're here because I consider this to be a continuation of the conversation that we started last year. And I want to share some things that we've been doing in our own research in the Department of Gerontology and that we're seeing in research largely around the country, around the world, about ageism. Ageism, all right? So what if I told you that by changing one of your practices in your care planning or in your work, or whatever that is broadly defined, or maybe in your life in general, that you could improve psychological health outcomes for people in things like cognition and a sense of self-mastery and confidence and self-esteem? Would you want to try that? Okay. And if I also told you that by changing just that one practice, you could improve physical health outcomes like blood pressure and reducing heart disease, and even things like balance. Would you want to try that? Yeah, okay. If I also told you that by not implementing that practice, you could actually be reducing people's life expectancy by up to 7.5 years, would you think, maybe I should try that? Okay, what if I told you that this isn't just for patients and clients, this is for all people of all ages, all of us in this room, would you think, okay, maybe I'll look into that? Okay, what if I also, okay, this gets a little harder. What if I told you that this might be one of the most challenging things that you ever had to do? It might take you your whole career and maybe your whole lifetime to master it. Would you maybe have some call for pause? Maybe? Okay. So this is very valuable and important, but it's also very hard. Most of the best things are hard, right? We didn't get here because life was easy. No. Right? People ask me, how long does it take you to prepare a presentation that's going to be engaging and hopefully impactful? And I say it takes about 20 minutes and 30 years. Right? You know what I'm talking about, right? You know what I'm talking about. So that's exactly what I'm talking about today. So you've probably already gathered that this practice is about disrupting ageism. And it is so much the foundation of everything that we're doing because we can focus on day-to-day practices, but until we change our thinking about things and until we're really clear and careful about our own perspectives, our own thinking about our own aging, we could possibly be transmitting negative self-perceptions to the people that we care for, the people that we serve, the people in our lives, and of course also we're internalizing those behaviors into our own thinking. Right? Okay. All right. So last year when I was here, and thank you again, I mean, I feel really, really so honored that you would think to include me 2 years in a row. Last year when I was here, I did actually go back and look at the video. It's painful to watch yourself on video, isn't it? I have to confess, I only watched about 5 minutes of it. And then I quickly switched to some of the other really great presenters who've been here. But anyway, so last year when I was here, I talked to some about broken thinking and how our thinking about aging is broken. And that's why I say that was kind of part one. This is kind of part two. And hopefully today we'll have more of your talking than my talking because this is going to be more activity-based. But, you know, along that line, some foundation about this broken thinking. You know, it's very easy to absorb these fallacies that we in our thinking about aging and the lifespan. It's been automatic. And those ideas, they become implicit in our thinking. They become part of our master cultural narrative, right? It's in us. It's in everything. We're going to talk about some of those examples and how you might disrupt that along the way, because I want us to all become disruptors. But banishing those false thoughts is not only unsettling, it is much harder. I frequently, when people make comments about, you know, their attitudes and feelings about aging that seem to be very one-sided, and I start to try to share some positive experiences and things that happen with aging, I can watch people immediately gloss over, right? Which is an indication, part, that they're tired of my harping, maybe. That partly is it. But also about how ingrained people are in their own direction, right? So I'd like to actually even just start with that word aging. I've been thinking about this a lot because, you know, we talk about that word, aging. Well, I'm a developmentalist, right? My focus is about lifespan development, and aging is just another word for living. It's just another word for development. And as a developmentalist, I know that development, or living, or the accumulation of years, involves growth, maintenance, and decline. And that no stage of the lifespan is any better or worse than any other. But that is not what our macro-cultural narrative about aging tells us. People say things like, the aging population. What does that, the aging pop, okay, we've been here for how long now? 21 minutes? We have all aged 21 minutes, every single one of us. We age every minute of every day. Don't raise your eyebrows at me, that's a blessing. That's a blessing. We age because aging is just another word for living. Hallelujah, we get to do that, right? Okay. I don't know if y'all have read Ashton Applewhite's book called The Ageist Manifesto. I think it's a great kind of introduction to this concept. She says that all aging is successful aging, not just the sporty kind, because anything else means that you're dead, right? Aging means living. But that is not what we're told in our master cultural narrative. People believe that everything before a certain chronological age, that's individually defined, is all about growth and gain. All about growth and gain. Harder, faster, stronger, isn't this wonderful? Woohoo, we're 20, isn't life great? I'm sorry, I was 20. It wasn't great. I was poor, I was stupid. It was not so great. I was very emotionally dysregulated. I don't know about you, right? But that is not the master cultural narrative. The master cultural narrative is that that's not called aging, but that is aging, right? From birth or conception, whatever you want to believe about that, that's your own thing, but, right? Aging is the entire lifespan. But our master cultural narrative tells us that young adulthood, adolescence, childhood, that's all growth and gain, and then whenever you hit that hill, whenever that is for you, which is individually determined, everything else is decline. Nothing could be further from the truth. Nothing could be further from the truth. I'd be happy to come back next year and just do a whole presentation about all of the positive things that happen after 40. Okay. All right. Oh, I can't be there? I'm almost 50. No. I am almost 50. Okay, so I can't wait to talk. You need to write that in one of your bubbles. You need to write that in one of your bubbles. Because, okay, what she said to me was, you can't be there. Okay, which suggests that being young is better than being old.
It suggests that as you get older, everything about you is supposed to decline and you don't look the concept of what an old
person is. The concept of what an old person is, yes. Which is about labeling, right? It's about othering. It's about othering, right? Those people, right, who look like this. And I think that's an excellent example of how we have a very specific idea about what old looks like, what aging looks like. No. Well, maybe, right? Broken thinking, right? We're all sitting in this soup of broken thinking in our macrocultural narrative. Oh, we're going to go over so many examples. I can't wait. Okay, because many of our narratives are largely unexplored. We accept what is the common thought about aging, which is really just living. Aging is not even the right word. And I think part of that is challenging because we don't have the right words. It's hard to replace the words that aren't working with the right words when we don't even have them. Okay, so many of that narrative, unexplored narrative, is what influences the fact that we are communicating these false attitudes about aging with ourselves and also how we transmit them to people in the world. One of the concepts that in our research in the Department of Gerontology, Jenny Inker and Tracy Gendron and myself, is about the concept of relational ageism. That ageism is something that we socially transmit. That the idea of this macro-cultural narrative is something that we share between each other. It is contagious. Okay, we catch it from each other, which is why internalized ageism is not only dangerous for ourselves, but it's dangerous for the people that we work with in our world. Okay, because people catch it from us. It's a socially transmitted disease. That's going to be the next t-shirt, I think. Okay. So you have a choice, right? You have a choice, really, because according to Becca Levy's research about ageism and this how it's transmitted, the bad news is that negative self-concepts negatively impact your life expectancy. Right? 7.5 years. Right? If you internalize a negative self-concept, particularly about your aging, then it affects you psychologically, physiologically, and reduces your life expectancy. The good news, is that a positive self-concept about aging can enhance and lengthen your life expectancy. Again, this is transmitted. It's not just about the people that we serve, it's about us. And it's about that relation between in terms of what we're communicating. It's a choice. So as William James says, if you can change your mind, you can change your life. Okay, so why is that so hard? I don't know. Oh, I do. It's hard, right? Did I say that at the beginning? It's hard. How many of you are familiar with the story of Pollyanna? Okay, let me ask. How many people are really familiar with the story? Or are you really just familiar with the misinterpretation, misrepresentation of this young girl and how people think that she was naive? Flibbertigibbet, right? Rose-colored glasses. Yeah, what do you think? You don't have to confess. Because I'm going to share the story with you right now. When was the last time somebody read you a story? Has it been a while? Two days. Good for you. Did you love it? It's great. It's great. It's something we should do more of, right? Don't you love it when somebody reads to you? It's a it's a feeling of comfort. It's a feeling of home. It's also very educational because, you know, a lot of our social mores and macro-cultural narrative is transmitted to us through storytelling. Okay, so this is the story of Pollyanna. No, I'm not going to read you all 300 pages, don't worry. You'd have to come back for next year. Okay, next year I'll have a new story, I promise. Okay, so this is Pollyanna has just moved into her Aunt Polly's house, and she's having a conversation with her Aunt Polly's housekeeper, whose name is Nancy. Okay, so we begin. "You don't seem to see any trouble being glad about everything," retorted Nancy. Pollyanna laughed softly. "Well, that's the game, you know, anyway." "The game?" "Yes, the Just Be Glad game." "Whatever in the world are you talking about?" "Why, it's a game. Father told me about it." "It's lovely," rejoined Pollyanna. "We've played it always, ever since I was a little girl." She's only 11, just to add that. "Okay, I told the ladies' aid, and they played it, some of them." "Well, what is it? I ain't much on games, though." Pollyanna laughed again, but she sighed, too, and a gathering of twilight in her face looked thin and wistful. "Why, we began it on some crutches that came in the missionary barrel." "Crutches?" Nancy said. "Yes, you see, I'd wanted a doll, and Father had written to them. But when the barrel came, the lady wrote and said that there hadn't been any dolls that come in. But the little crutches had, so they sent them along, thinking, you know, might be handy for some child sometime. And that's where the game began." "Well, I must say, I can't see any game about that," Nancy said almost irritably. "Oh, yes, the game was, it was just to find something about everything to be glad about." "No matter what it was," rejoined Pollyanna earnestly, "and we began right then on the crutches." "Well, goodness me, I can't see anything good about that. I can't see anything to be glad about getting a pair of crutches when you wanted a doll." Pollyanna clapped her hands. There is," she crowed. "But I couldn't see it either at first. And Father had to tell it to me." "Well, then suppose you just tell me," said Nancy. "Why, just to be glad because you don't need them." "You see, it's just as easy as that when you know how." Okay, so where did Pollyanna's father come up with this idea of this glad game? I'm going to tell you. Okay. So now Pollyanna's, she's living with her Aunt Polly, and she meets a minister who lives in this new community. And she's having a conversation with the minister, and she says, "Yes, I used to ask him," meaning her father, "I used to ask him, just as I did you, if he was glad to be a minister." And the man under the tree smiled a little sadly. "Well, what did he say?" "Oh, he always said he was, of course. But most always, he said, too, he wouldn't stay a minister a minute if it wasn't for the rejoicing texts." "The what?" The Reverend Paul Ford's eyes left the leaf and gazed wonderingly at Pollyanna's merry little face. "Well, that's what Father used to call him," she laughed. "Of course, the Bible didn't name him that. But it's all those that begin with, be glad in the Lord, rejoice greatly, or shout with joy. And all that, you know, there's such a lot of them. Once when Father felt especially sad, he counted them. And there were 800 of them." 800? "Yes. That told you, 800 that told you to rejoice and be glad. You know, that's why Father named them the rejoicing texts." "Oh, yes. He said that he felt better right away. That first day he thought to count them. And he said if God took the trouble to tell us 800 times to be glad and rejoice, he must want us to do it some." So there you have it. Pollyanna, who has been misquoted and misinterpreted for years, not naive, not that she's ignoring or having rose-colored glasses about the world. She knows she got crutches. But she's operating within a different macro-cultural narrative and making a choice to to see the goodness, right? Just as we think about young adulthood and middle adulthood, some is all about growth and gain and growth and gain. That's not the truth, right? And our macrocultural narrative tells us that middle, the other side of middle, other half of middle, late life, beyond, is all negative and decline. Nothing is ever one thing, right? There are positives and negatives of all stages of the lifespan, and you have the opportunity to look at people more holistically, look at ourselves more holistically, look at other people more holistically, rather than seeing it all as one thing. It's a different macro-cultural narrative. It is a choice. As William James says, if you can change your mind, you can change your life. So why is this so hard? Okay, let's pray. No, let's just click this other button. Okay. So why is this so hard? This is your brain. This is your brain on thoughts. This is how ageism, this is how all isms happen. Okay, so take a look at this for a minute, right? You have this in your handouts too. We begin with observations of the world. It moves to impressions. It moves to labeling and categorization. This helps us think and operate in our world and develop heuristics and saves us time by categorizing. But sadly, those categorizations, those labeling, that othering, putting people in boxes, moves into stereotypes, prejudice, and discrimination. That is the concept behind, the theoretical foundation behind disrupting ageism. It's going to be impossible to not have observations, right? That's what we do. They come in through our senses. We observe things, right? We have impressions of things. We all sit within this macro-cultural narrative, this soup of our culture, our community, the things that we've learned. Those impressions are there. How do we disrupt this process? Somewhere between observations, impressions, labeling, to discrimination. How do we make that happen? How do we make that happen? All right? We do that through choice, right? We do that through what William James says, if you can change your mind, you can change your life, right? If you change your mind, you can change your behavior, both internalized ageism. You can change your behavior in terms of how you present your attitudes about ageism, aging, life, living, to the people that you work with in your world. Now, I asked you earlier, if you knew all this, would you try it? If you knew how hard it was going to be, would you try it? Well, now I want to ask you, if you know all this, because we're going to talk about it, if you know that this is a powerful influence, and you know how hard it's going to be, but at the same time, once you know you can't not know, then don't you have an ethical obligation to try it? Okay, well, I hope you'll buy into that, because I know that that's the place that I come from. That if I know that something I could do could improve the lives of people that I work with and serve, I would definitely want to do that. So bear with me for that, because I hope that we'll all be in the same tribe. Okay, so this is what the language of ageism looks like, and it's on a continuum. And we're going to, in your handout, you'll see that you have some examples of these, because that's what I really want us to talk about, are some examples of these. And some of them are more obvious than others. And I'm not going to spend so much time on the obvious ones, because they're obvious, right? So this is, and you'll see this in your handouts, the language of explicit bias. The language of explicit bias. This is explicit ageism. If somebody says to you, well, this person is too old to hire for this job, that's pretty obviously ageist, right? Okay. Did he say true?
I mean, it could be true.
What kind of jobs are you too old to hire for?
Someone who's got to run the streets of New York.
Run the streets of New York. Unless they've been running the streets of New York all their lives, right? Yeah?
Or if they're 95.
And if they've still been running the streets of, right?
I go fast enough to get the job.
What is that job?
I don't know yet.
I don't either. Okay. We should look at that job description. Okay. So if we're thinking about this from a person-centered approach, rather than labeling a person because of a specific chronology, you know, you would want to see, is there really something about that job that the person was really unable to do because of the job requirements? It seems like there are lots of things that people say a person is too old for that really do not match with what the requirements of the jobs are. Next year, when I get to come back and talk about all the positive things that happen after 40, you know, one of the key ones is integrative thought. And most of the jobs that most of us have require integrative thought and the ability to pull all a lifespan of experiences together and knowledge gained. And that is certainly much better after 40 than it is before 40. And that's what most of our jobs are about. Okay, all older people have dementia. No. You know, probably there should be more fear about the fear of dementia than actually dementia itself, because that's really the thing that seems to be troubling to folks. There's so much more anxiety about it than the reality of it actually happening. And then all older people are incontinent. Well, you know, all of those ads for poise pads and things and adult incontinence products would tell you that all older people are incontinent. That would tell you that that was true. I hope that we'll get a chance to talk about lifestyle and how lifestyle and age are not the same thing. And so many of the things that we say are age-related are really much more lifestyle-dependent. But it's an easy cop-out to say, this is because I'm old, because then it's something I can't do anything about. Okay. All right, the language of microaggression. Okay, microaggression are these daily assaults, brief usually, oftentimes brief to the point that you say, I didn't even have a chance to respond to that. Do y'all have those experiences sometimes? Somebody will say something either to you or about somebody else in your presence and you think, oh, and then you end up churning for the rest of the day. Yes, do you have an example of that?
I was in the eye doctor's here about 3 years ago. I was 83 at the time. And in the course of the conversation, I said something like, I was going to do a drive somewhere. He says, you're still driving?
Yeah. He said, you're still driving? And did he leave the room bleeding? I mean, what was your response to that? Nothing. Did you respond?
I changed doctors.
Right. You changed doctors. Good for you. Vote with your feet. I think that's an excellent example. Truly an excellent example. Thank you. Because if your healthcare provider does not promote positive attitudes about your development in your living, then that person does not have your best interest at heart. And if they are a health care, are they health care providers? They're not illness providers, right? We are not illness providers, we are health care providers. Then we should be thinking we have an ethical responsibility to promote that in the people that we serve. Wow. Great example, thank you. Okay, so these are things that are individual assaults. One of the places that you can't help but be assaulted is in the birthday card aisle, right? I went recently to try to find an anniversary card for my cousins who were in their 80s, and it was their 67th wedding anniversary. So, you know, they have cards for 50, 55, 60, but there's not a specific one for 67. So when you try to look for a card that's for people who have been married for 67 years, Well, there just doesn't seem to be a good fit. Because it talks about, oh, you know, we can't believe you're still alive this long. Right? And we laugh about that. But it is not funny. It is not funny that we say those things to people, right? It is not funny, right? Just like this experience with your doctor. Not funny that somebody would say that, yes.
My mom's boyfriend is 90, and my mom's 88. And I went to look for a birthday card for him. It's almost impossible to find a birthday card for someone 90, period.
Period.
That doesn't describe someone as basically decrepit and should be in a box somewhere. Just to find one that's light and upbeat was almost impossible.
And should that be the case?
What got me is how hard it was to find anything that said 90. Like yeah. There's an expectation you're not going to make it that long.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a tragedy. You know, last year when I talked about our shifting baseline and how this is partly why we have such broken thinking, because we're still adjusting to this expanded longevity. You know, so this is a new thing. It's not a new thing that people have gotten so old. It's a new thing that so many people have gotten so old.
One more thing on that topic, which ties back to what the comment you made before.
Oh, dear.
We don't have, I'll speak for myself. When I think of someone who is older, that image keeps shifting because, A, I'm older, but also we don't have a history of reference points. My grandmother lived to 110. How many 110-year-old people do you know? And what is the picture you have in your mind of people that live to 110? And so what's our reference points for it? We don't have a broad base.
Yes. And I think that's such an essential point. And one of the reasons that I think we need to be gentle with ourselves about combating and addressing our own ageism, because we don't have the right language and we don't have role models for it. You know, one of the things about in education, you know, we talk about scaffolding and we talk about affinity. So you want to make sure that the person that you're learning something from, and this could be in a formal educational setting or it could be in an informal setting, that you have an affinity for them. You can see yourself in that person. And so if we don't have role models, or maybe we just have one, maybe you just know one person, that's really hard if it's one out of all of the other negative messages. And it's a drop in the bucket, you know? It's a tear in the sea. It's just one tiny little infusion or injection of a positive message, which is why this disruption is so essential. You know, it's why we want to be able to share this message with as many people as possible. So through more of a tribal kind of way, we can all go out and be disruptive. We can all go out and along that continuum of how thoughts and observations become behavior, we can say, whoa, 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 whoa. Let's dial this back a little bit. And think about, are we really saying what we mean? Or could we reach for something better? Right? Okay. So these are the easy ones because they're obvious. Right? You won't learn this new app. You're too old. Well, so last year, or this year actually, but in the spring for our 40th anniversary, we created these cards because one of the things that we find most frequently, as you know, people have identified, is that somebody will say something and you'll go, I didn't know how to respond to that, right? And then you're in your car and you're thinking, that would have been the perfect thing to say. Right? And it's you kind of lost the moment, right? So we created these cards for people. And, you know, based on some of the things that we hear a lot, and so one of them is related to this app, about this app comment about, you know, I don't want to have to teach you how to use this app again, Mom, you know. And the mom responds, well, I never said that to you when I was teaching you how to use a spoon. Right? So sometimes, you know, that's the other place. Sometimes you want to respond with kindness. If the person is really coming from a place of lack of understanding, if the person is coming from more of a microaggressive kind of place, you might want to come back with a response that's more level with what they've said to you. right? Because you want to speak to people in the same language. I'm not suggesting that we be unkind, but sometimes we want to be a little more forceful, depending on how the person is approaching you. I believe that most people who are experiencing internalized ageism are coming at it from a fear standpoint, from an unexplored standpoint, and that really requires kindness. Right? It's more of a questioning approach, and we'll talk about that. Yes?
You know, it is hard to sometimes think of a quick response that would really be appropriate, but I had a dear friend, he died a few years ago, and we were in this conversation one day, and he said, you know, Linda, whenever somebody says something really off the wall to me, it's totally, he said, just look at them and go, really?
Yeah.
It's something you could always remember
you
to say.
Always remember.
And he goes,
to say
don't
it.
Say anything more after that. He said, just stop there. He said, and just let them think. You hope that they'll think a little bit more about what they just said.
Yes.
And I have used it several times.
Several times.
And it really is something you can always remember to say, and just step back and just look at them.
That's brilliant. That's brilliant, Linda. And yes, you're right, you can use that in any setting. Yes. And it just causes people to pause. Right? And then you know that you have had a response. And you don't have to, you know, seethe and beat yourself up, because I get a lot of calls and emails from my students who say, you won't believe what just happened, and I had no idea what to say. You know, that's brilliant. And the more of those types of things you can just have in your toolkit to pull out that you're able to have a multi-response to, the better you're going to feel. And at the end of the day, it's not likely you can change somebody else's behavior. You know, that's a short list of people that you're actually going to be able to change somebody's behavior. We're ultimately only responsible for our own behavior. And so you can feel safe in the fact that you've had a response that you said, I feel good about that. That's the goal. Okay, so let's move past the easy ones. Mm-hmm. Oh, wait, that one, okay. All right, so you see this empty box? It's a circle. Sorry, I do know. I did take geometry. That's a circle. Okay, this is for you to come up with your own examples of these things. Okay, so this is the language of internalized ageism. Now, rather than giving you a definition of internalized ageism, I think it's going to become obvious when we talk about these examples. Now, then you can tell me what a definition might be, and you can tell me some examples you've seen of this. All right, so where a person might say, I'm not old, I'm just more mature. Mm-hmm. Okay? Health is for the young. When you're our age, you do the best you can. And then this final one, a 76-year-old woman says, nope, I'm not old, and then refers to the residence where she lives as those old people. You know that, right? Right? Okay, we know people who talk like that. Okay, so from that, what does internalized ageism, what is that? What does that sound like?
It sounds like making yourself old.
Like making yourself old.
I work with a lot of people who are younger than I am. Mm-hmm. And during the initial session, while they're telling, I tell them a little bit about me. And I didn't realize it until today's session that I was saying, oh yeah, I'm old.
Mm-hmm.
And I look at it, and it's like, because I know I don't look my age, I'll be 67, and I know I don't look my age, and most people go, you can't be, and whatever it is you can't be,
mm-hmm.
Why not? So there's a double-edged sword here. Why can't I be 67, vital, happy, enthusiastic, alive, and yet at the other level of it is, I almost want to be proud of it, but when I say I am old, I don't want it to sound like I've died. I'm just old.
Yeah.
You know, so I guess that's an internal place I'm still going through as to what that.
Mm-hmm. I've been around a while.
Right.
And
right.
I've
been around a while.
Mm-hmm. And when people say those kinds of things, we're suggesting that old is a bad thing. Because that is our macro-cultural narrative. When in reality, to be able to say, I've been around for a while and I'm old, I mean, number one, old should be a neutral descriptor.
Well, to me, it's like I don't have to go through what you've been through because yes, I've done it.
Yes.
And
embracing that as a positive is a place that I would like for us to be, right? I think oftentimes even when we say those things to people, they think we're expressing it as a negative, even if we may not even mean it as a negative, right? Yes.
So I was going to say that very thing, that age, that just that word age does not have to imply a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a story about that that was a real eye-opener for me. I was working in Korea, and I went on a hike with a coworker who was much younger than I. It was a few years ago, I was about 63 at the time. We got to the top of this, the last 100 feet of the climb, and it was very intense. And so I got to the top and I was out of breath. There was a whole group of older Korean men up there. And in Korea, it's really okay to walk up to somebody and ask you how old you are. So I got up and I'm huffing and I'm puffing, and the oldest looking guy in the group comes over to me and he says, how old are you? And I said, well, I'm 63. Oh, he immediately started bowing to him. So I started bowing to him. And he said, oh no, he says, I'm 62. We respect you. We respect you. And I thought, wow. I said, so I'm getting respect for being the oldest from these outside people. So maybe I need to internally start respecting, you know, affording myself that respect. Mm-hmm. So that was just a huge, you know, bow to my age.
Yes.
You know, bow out of respect.
I think that is an excellent example of how, you know, we take these concepts of saying, you know, I'm not new to this. I've been around a while. I'm old, yay me, to I bow to my own age, right? I saw a thing on Facebook not too long ago that said we should stop referring it to age. We should refer to it as levels, right? Which is a similar kind of concept, you know, in gaming language. I'm referring, you know, I'm not a gamer, but that was what it was about. You know, I refer to myself in levels, right? But that starts with us. You know, that starts with us and demanding it of other people. Enid?
I love the phrase that Gloria Steinem said years ago. Someone said, you look great for 40, and she said, this is what 40 looks like.
Yes, because of course 67 can be all of those things.
Well,
but because
that's what I was referring to, we don't have, what are the models we use now for a person in our 60s, a person in our 70s, a person in our, what's the picture you have in your own mind that causes somebody to have, oh, you're that old,
right.
Or you
that's
can't
right.
be that old,
that's
or
right.
whatever that is.
Right, and you know, probably people know people of all ages. It's just because we have this image in a box of what over 60 or over 70 looks like that people are not awakened to it. And so the idea of asking people, really? Really? Is that, you know, I think that's a great way to just crack that open a little bit. You know, that's really the goal of disruption. Just crack it open a little bit so people can have this experience of discovering it for themselves. Because what I find is that once people are awakened to the idea of, oh, ageism is a thing, it exists just like, say, sexism and racism and homophobia, you know, it's the same thing. It's the only difference is that, of course, this happens to all of us. Right? You had your hand open, sir.
Okay, every time I go to the doctor recently, the past few years, he'll say, well, I think for your age, you're in pretty good shape. It's always for your age.
For your age, right?
Your age.
Because that's a thing, right? We put that in the box. I would say, really? What do you mean by that? Yes, ma'am.
I think we have to look, too. I think ageism is cultural, American
mm-hmm.
culture, like
yeah,
other cultures.
Right.
Like Sue was saying, respect age
mm-hmm.
very much. But we're a throwaway culture, and your age, you know, put you out into the pasture, and that's what we're fighting against.
Well, and you know, what they found is that cultures that are very youth-centric which many cultures are very youth-centric and very focused on productivity, like ours is, are about capitalism, and the folks at the youngest and the oldest segments of the lifespan are ones that are not as productive in terms of capitalism, and which of course suggests that money is your only metric. And of course, you know, there are so many things about our culture and most cultures that would completely fall apart if we didn't have the volunteerism and family support of elders. It would be impossible. You know, our entire long-term care system is basically on the backs of family caregivers, you know, because that's who's really providing the majority of the support. But because that doesn't fit within our mindset of a capitalistic system, we don't give that credence. But that is really the truth. And actually, Christine Jensen could talk much better about that than I could. I saw a hand in the back. There you are. Yes, ma'am.
In many cultures, it's been studied and researched that, like I know in the Native American culture, children's food, their language dysregulated, teenagers, they really look to the elders as the foundation to, and in tradition and culture, or what you are to stay grounded, becomes the building block. So that's why, as the young lady, she was honored for her age and for her knowledge and wisdom. And so that whole mindset, and it's a circular life form and not a linear life form, that you're always climbing to the top of your top because you're always aspiring for more, whereas in a more circular cultural aspect, you're looking at, you know, life becoming that circle, ongoing, continually feeding itself to survive.
Thank you for that. And that's a wonderful, in my mind, description of something that we could aspire to culturally. And it reminds me actually of the work of Bill Thomas and his concept of elderhood. That the notion is, you know, we're all overwhelmed with this glut of information, but information doesn't necessarily bring knowledge. Storytelling and wisdom giving and peacekeeping, which are the tasks of elderhood, according to Bill Thomas, very much similar to a Native American culture. And that circular mindset of learning from each other. You know, in fact, it makes me think some, too, about how, you know, we know intergenerational programs are really on the boom, and, you know, people say, oh, we just got to get some old people and some kids together, and won't this be nirvana and rainbows and unicorns? And that's not really the thing. It's not about having different ages in the room. It's about sharing knowledge, you know, across things that people share of interest and in common, whether that's culture or whether that's practices or whether that's things that people want to learn together. It's about your philosophy. It's about getting your thinking straight, right, before you try to move forward with an activity. Okay, so what are some things here? Internalized ageism. The idea that this is implicit, right? It's implied that old is bad and young is good, that we're buying into the notion that it's gain and growth and to a certain chronological point, sometime in, you know, young adulthood or early midlife, and then after that it's all downhill. That is the mindset that people buy into in our macrocultural narrative. It is automatic in our thinking, and it is unexplored, undiscovered, right? The idea of being able to crack that open in a way and ask questions like, really? Right? Not just to other people, but to ourselves. Why do I believe that? Really?
What did my parents teach
you? Yes, that's right. What did people teach us when we had fewer role models? Yes.
It was on Facebook recently. There was a thing going around that showed a nun who was doing, and she's in her 80s,
yes,
or something like that.
Right.
And she was doing
Iron Man.
Mm-hmm. And somebody said, you can't do this. And she goes, or something like, you can't do this. And she said, why not? Or why are you trying to do something? This is just one of many I've done.
Yeah.
And it never crossed her mind not to.
Yes, yes. Okay, so can I tell you there were two ways that was presented on Facebook. One was from a group called Growing Boulder, right? Which was, I've forgotten her name, Sister?
I don't remember.
Okay, so, and it was all about that she didn't see any other way to do it. The other actually turned into, I think, a Nike ad, and it was all her saying, of course, this is my 40th Iron Man. But then at the end, Nike just sabotaged the whole thing because it said unlimited youth. Right? And it said unlimited youth. And so we can't just be satisfied with, this is wonderful. We have to say that this is youth. The woman is 90 years old. She is not young. I'm sorry. Let's not even pretend. She is old. There are wonderful things about being old, right?
She's doing an Ironman.
That's right. And our macrocultural narrative would not tell us that there are wonderful things about being old. Okay. But marketing would tell us that we should be ashamed of being old, and we have to call it youth to kind of whitewash it to make it something else. Okay. I'm sorry?
Have you called them?
I have not, but I suspect that somebody on my team has. Yeah, because two different representations of the exact same thing. One turned it into a marketing thing. Marketing is about telling you you need something that you may not need because their job is to make money. Ta-da. Okay, so Gary has given me the signal to take a break. So we're going to take a break. And then we're going to come back and fill in some of your circles. Yes. Okay, I wanted to back up to one that I think I accidentally skipped over about the language of implicit bias. And actually, this relates to one of the things that has come up a couple of times already, that when we say things like a person is 94 years old and still sharp as a tack. Okay, that's a simple addition of that one word, still. Still. And in our department, in the research that we're doing, we call that an uncharacteristic characteristic. Because we wouldn't expect, holy smokes, that a person could be 94 and still maintain their mental capacities, when in reality that is the norm. Right? That is the norm, that at 94, barring a disease, you would still have, that's normal. But that's not what the expectation is. That's not what our macrocultural narrative tells us. Our macrocultural narrative says it's great, 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 and then you fall off the deep end. Nothing could be further from the truth. Okay. Still, one of those words to really be careful about. Still and but. Right? I'm 90, but I feel great for my age. Right? But, right? Why can't it just be and? Yes, ma'am.
It's like giving a compliment and then taking it back.
And taking it back.
Yeah. It's like saying to your kid, oh, you got a B. Well, next time, get an A.
Exactly. Oh, and don't, I mean, I felt that when you said that. Don't you know what that feels like to say that to a person? It's just like saying, you look great for your age. Oh,
I hate that.
Right? And you know why we're not completely up in arms about things that we hate? We should, sometimes we should say, really? And sometimes we should say something a little more strong. It's Friday morning, I'm on video, I won't say what I say. But, you know, sometimes we need to be, if someone is coming, approaching with some microaggression, right? You know, maybe we need to come back with a little like, that's not okay. Maybe we've been nice about this a little too long. Still, we've been nice about it a little too long. Okay, I love this one. She has a young spirit. Oh, isn't she cute? Isn't she cute?
That's so objectifying.
It is so objectifying.
It's like, isn't that a cute wind-up doll?
Right.
Okay.
Isn't that cute? But, you know, a lot of people who meet me the first time, not people who actually know me, but people who meet me for the first time and they say, oh, you work in gerontology. Oh, you work in aging. Like aging isn't everything, but, you know, they don't know. They haven't had an opportunity to learn that yet. Oh, you work in gerontology with old people. That is so nice. You are so nice. Right? I love old people. They are so sweet. Right? Not realizing that is so infantilizing and degrading. Right, that we call ambivalent ageism. Because it sounds like, as you're saying, it sounds like you're giving a compliment, but really you are denigrating that person's power. Right? Not to mention that they don't know me, that I'm not really nice. That I got into this because some stuff is broken and I want to help fix it. And social injustice is reprehensible and we need to do lots of work here. And that nice doesn't usually fix that, unfortunately. But it's a nice place to start. Okay, and here you look young, or he looks younger every day. He looks younger every day. Like that's a good thing. Again, like old is bad, denigrating a person's lived experience and saying you should be ashamed of the fact that you're older. Yes, ma'am.
Well, you know, we live in a society that people is trying to get younger as they get older.
That's right.
You know, like they get facelifts and they get tummy tucks. They get, nobody wants to look like the real person that they are.
That's right.
So that's why people, a lot of times people say things like that. Like, you look young because you didn't really get the facelift or the tummy tuck. But you still look good.
You still look good. And again, you know, think you're absolutely right in terms of how that is implied so much in our own cultural narrative, that youth is good, that it's about growth and gain, and it's all happening, you know, rainbows and unicorns on this side of chronology. And then that one-sided view of biological aging, physiological aging is all the focus of late life, right? Rather than looking at the whole person and recognizing that from a biopsychosocial spiritual side, there's growth and decline and maintenance at all phases of the lifespan. But that is not what our implicit messages of aging tell us. Right? That's the piece that we need to turn around.
So what are you trying to say, that we need to learn how to say things?
Exactly. That's right.
That's what we're going to do. Really? Right? We're going to learn how to say different things to people. Okay, so are there other things that you'd add to this bubble? If you could read it, are there things that you would add to the bubble? Go ahead.
I was just thinking that the baby boomers, we've driven the American culture from the time we were born. And there's more and more discussions on different television and radio shows about the aging culture. And I wonder if we will drive a change in this thinking.
I've been wondering that myself for a long time. Are you doing that? Are you doing that?
I think so.
Do you? Do you think that that's changing for better?
We're working longer. You know, I think, but you know, we have to not apologize for it. We have to.
Yes. Right. Okay. So I think having more older people in our population raises the awareness that there are more older people in the population.
We want more magnifier glasses. We're demanding that the companies give us.
But is that changing the thinking? Is that changing the thinking? I'm not sure that it is.
I think some of the younger managers are realizing the older people are more dependable and reliable.
There's plenty of research that supports that older employees are more reliable.
Yes.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Well, I oftentimes think about, like, since I'll reflect back, how old was my mom when I was this age?
Yes.
And my mom was a wonderful lady, but she was never, like, super physically fit. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I have to chuckle and I think, gosh, I'm 59 now, and when my mom was 59, there's no way she would have ever even dreamt of going out on a bicycle or jogging 3 to 5 miles. And so I think that as the baby boomers, I think as a group, we are more in tune to staying physically fit. At least a lot of the folks that I know, and even where I live, I see a lot of folks, because I think also as I've aged and gotten older, I have more time to spend on doing that than I did when I was 35 or 40,
right,
when I worked and drove 120 miles round trip and had 3 small children.
Yes.
So I think that there's just so many benefits to that. And I do think we are maybe changing as a group, hopefully.
Yes, and I think that it takes a combination of those attitudes to say, look, there are more of us, more boomers, who have made changes culturally in every segment across their lifespans to be able to come together with a unified voice about, or maybe not a unified voice, but at least a voice that is not perpetuating negative stereotypes about aging, right? And I think that's about demanding that happen. Back here and then up here.
So I'm a baby boomer, and I'm still working. But I also feel like because I know this ageism exists, that I should work the system. And so I know I'm invisible in certain circumstances. Like I can walk into an ICU unit with nobody questioning me because I'm old. Or I can go to the airport and stand in the shorter line because they think I'm older than I am. And so I think the baby boomers are becoming aware of me and using it.
Yeah. Because you know, last time I checked, invisibility was a superpower. Right? I know it's something that particularly women in midlife and later complain about, that I've become invisible, and I think, well, thank God, if the alternative is being ogled on the street, invisibility, sign me up.
Invisibility can be an advantage.
That's right. And I think that is an excellent point. I'm going to add that. Jenny, are you writing that down? Okay, Jenny's writing that down.
I'm sitting next to her. I went out my 80th birthday this year. I got my doctorate when I was 52 and published my first book 2 years ago.
Awesome.
But when I go to the airport now, because I've had a heart attack about 3 times 10 years back, I'm in a wheelchair. Well, the first time I did that, I didn't want to look around and see who saw me. I sit there proudly now, and I'm going to tell you, they treat me like royalty. And I get to board the plane first. And they take my luggage off and wait for me with the wheelchair. Yeah, I need this system, okay? But what she's saying, it's respectful. I was ashamed at first. So don't be ashamed of it. Just people want to help you. They want to help you.
I think that that's an excellent point. I think, you know, people have this internal, you know, dissonance in their own brains about, I know that I respect individual older people, right? But at the macro level, we all buy into this thinking. And so everybody is sitting in this same complex thinking. We are in it ourselves. That's why you would be, you know, using a wheelchair and you would say, oh, this means I'm old and I'm supposed to think that's bad, rather than thinking of this as, you know, an assistance that would be supportive of me being able to remain engaged. That seems like a normal thing to respect and value, but that's not how our brains tell us to operate, because we go from observations to discrimination. Yes, here.
Yeah, I was reading the other day an article by a lady who was saying we have allowed ourselves to be hijacked by the anti-ageist, anti-sexist, anti-blah, blah, blah. There's easily a dozen. Mm-hmm. And if we need to go around every minute ready, triggered to go, and correct that on the spot, we have certainly done some harm to our social relations, to ourselves.
I think that's an excellent alternative approach, that you don't want to constantly be that person who is correcting, right? Which is why a response like, really? And let that person find their truth on their own, right? Because again, it's not your responsibility to change everybody's behavior, right? Our responsibility is to focus on our own behavior and make sure that we feel satisfied with how we're navigating within the world. So I think that's a very important point. You don't want to become that person that nobody wants to invite to dinner parties, because all you ever do is call people out on their ageism or their whatever. Yeah. I had to tell somebody this morning that I was out of t-shirts. It's Friday morning. I was out of t-shirts. I had to do laundry last night because I am so much on this disrupt ageism, platform that I do this all the time. And so I feel that, you know, that you don't want to become, you know, a one-trick pony that people don't want to hang out with.
You've talked about this a bit. I'm a gay man. I had to dealing with my own internalized homophobia. But where did that come from? and I came from messages that were given to me when I was this big. Right? I think we do the exact same thing, the messages we're giving to our children, our grandchildren, and the perceptions that they have about aging.
That's right.
When my father retired from the Navy and I was in the ninth grade, we moved in with my grandparents. They seemed ancient.
Yes.
They were only 60. But all the perception I had as a child, as a ninth grader, was that they were old. So where is it that we are working in a process of not only talking about this with ourselves, but where are we talking about the generations that are coming up and beginning to change the perceptions of what's going on?
I think that's an excellent question. And because, you know, I'm very sensitive to the fact that frequently we are so siloed and only talking to ourselves. And, you know, part of that can be done through programming, sure, through intergenerational opportunities to bring people together through shared interests. But to me, truly, that's a one-to-one-to-one conversation. And for us not to just share these messages professionally, but to share them in our families. Because the more separated we are from each other, whether that's generationally or whatever, the more likely we are to other people, right? To put people in other boxes. And so if you don't have multiple role models for what aging looks like, you know, the older we get, the more different we become from each other. That's called the heterogeneity of aging. It's not that all old people are, I mean, that's another ageist statement. So the more old people you know, the more they're going to be different from each other, and that's going to break down those stereotypes, because if you have multiple role models, you realize that. You know, when I was growing up, I had one grandmother who, you know, wore cotton house dresses that she sewed herself, and I ate, you know, my weight in fried chicken every week and chocolate pies, and, you know, she made quilts and, you know, had her own huge garden in the backyard. My other grandmother wore high heels and did line dancing. So, you know, when you're raised in that, you know, you go, these people are not alike, right? And so that concept is different for you when you have that role modeling from an early age. But, of course, to your point, I saw a Clearasil ad last night. Television. And it was something about, some things will change, but, you know, acne will go away. Some things will change, some things won't change. And it had an image of the boy. His mother comes in with the laundry basket and says, "Steven." He must have been looking at porn or something on his computer. I don't know. And then the second one was he's on a date with a girl, and his mother shows up, "Steven," with the laundry basket. And then the third image is he's off giving a lecture somewhere as Dr. Steven, and his mother shows up, "Steven." And then the final image is he's in a nursing home, and his mother shows up as a robot with the laundry basket, "Steven." Okay, this is our master cultural narrative. You're in your room looking, oh, maybe it was the porn. Y'all already talked about sex addiction. Okay, sorry, I won't go there. Maybe it he's in his room, he goes to, you know, on a date, he goes to school, he gets a degree, and then he's in the nursing home. What? What? That's our master cultural narrative. So until we give people, and I think that is the responsibility of older people, that is what Bill Thomas says about elderhood. That is the responsibility of elders, to demonstrate through storytelling, wisdom giving, and peacekeeping that there is a stage beyond adulthood, and we should embrace it because we've worked hard for this longevity. You know, this longevity we have, it's staggering. You know, 30 years in the last 100 years of expansion of longevity. Phenomenal, right? Embrace that, do something with it.
Where's the responsibility of the media like Disney and how they depict older characters in Disney for children?
Right. Can I call you Pollyanna? In the misinterpretation, naive approach to, right? Okay, so expecting then a capitalistic system that the media and the anti-aging movement is going to change their behavior, I'm sorry. That's not going to happen. Their job is to make money. Our jobs to make the world a better place, right? I love it. If you have a plan to make that happen, I am on your train. I will join you to make that happen. You know, but I think of all the other social movements that have eventually turned media and, well, I'll stop with that. Turned the media around in terms of how we represent marginalized groups. I think it has to start at a grassroots effort. People have to demand it, right? Because ultimately the media reflects us.
As do the markets.
As do the markets, yes. Yes.
I think part of the challenge is also, we're talking about living, but unless we change our view of diet, it's going to be really hard to change this perception, because that's how the old doc is in nursing homes. We don't have a culture that accepts, you know, dignity and dying at home or those types of things that allows us to die gracefully or choose our own death at times. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's really going to be hard to change what living looks like as an older person until we also change what dying looks like as an older person.
Mm-hmm. Which is certainly about having those conversations. Enid, you have a friend in the room. Uh-huh. Enid teaches our end-of-life classes in the Department of Gerontology at VCU. So, yeah, y'all hook up with Enid about that. Because truly, you know, in a youth-oriented, death-denying society, you know, that's one of the concepts behind this language, is the idea, gerontophobia, suggests that for many people, old reminds people of frailty and death. And so people don't want to have that reminder if that's a fear that you possess personally. So I can't not ask this question now that it's been raised. How many of you have talked to your own family members about your end-of-life wishes?
Kind of, right?
That's a large percentage. And, you know, obviously I'm with lots of professional groups on a regular basis, and it's surprising how many groups haven't had those conversations themselves, because they're hard conversations to have, I guess, unless it's part of your family narrative to have these conversations and start them early before there's some kind of crisis. You know, Home Instead has this book, and they, you know, talk about care. I don't remember the name of the book exactly, but it's blue. I can see it on my shelf. But they have, it's called the 40-70 rule, and they say that when the adult children are 40 and the parents are 70, you should start those conversations. Okay, so I believe in that concept wholeheartedly. That is way too late. Yeah. That's way too late, yeah.
I have a lawyer friend that reminded me that was really very interesting, and I have since done it, but she looked at me and she said, Linda, you have 2 children over 18.
Yes.
She said, you need to fill out all, and they're single. Mm-hmm. They need to have the POA and all of that done, and I sent it to both of my children and said, I need you to fill this out, and you can do it when you come home next time. And I really thought they'd push back or give me a hard time. Like, well, this is stupid. And they both did it, and I was so grateful for her to bring it up to me, because I had not thought about the fact that they are now of age that I wouldn't even be able to learn anything about if they were in an accident, because they did not sign that release. So I have all those forms done and signed and really feel good about that.
And, you know, what a gift for you, a comfort, and also a gift for your kids, you know, because if you know, if the situation happens where any of us cannot make decisions for ourselves, and someone has to worry if they're making the right decision, that's an enormous burden, right? But having that conversation and knowing that you're making the right decision is one of the greatest gifts you can give to somebody.
So I'm having that conversation. I have had the conversation, but it's a conversation. It's not a one-time little speech. But what I have found is that when I broach that, I'm pretty comfortable talking about it. They don't really you're not going to die for a long time. And I said, it's not really about that. It's not about when I'm going to die. It's me letting you know so that you don't have that burden, so that you know that these are my wishes.
That's right.
But I just think it's important for it to kind of be ongoing.
That's right.
Right. It's kind of like that sex talk.
It's not the talk. It's a conversation. Yeah. Right? Right. Just like sex, it shouldn't be the talk.
Exactly.
It should be a conversation. And we have so many opportunities to bring things up if, you know, when people are uncomfortable about talking
talking about you particularly or themselves particularly, there's enough going on in the media, you know, that you could say, oh my goodness, such and such happened. What do you think about that? And that gives you insights into what people, you know, to continue the conversation. Because it's, we can't avoid things that are painful. I'm sorry. It's going to be more painful if you don't have the conversation. Anyway, thanks for that little derailment.
How do you approach things? Because we're talking about this, when somebody is older and not as capable, still capable, but not as capable of living alone, order without falling into biases of making them older.
I think that that answer is going to reveal itself through some of these other things that we're going to talk about. Yeah, that's a great point. Okay, so implicit bias. We get that these are instilled in our thinking as part of our macrocultural narrative to the point that they are automatic for us, which makes it very hard for us to dismantle them. It's very easy to take them in. It's very hard to change them. Okay, so internalized ageism. Okay, I think this is one we talked about already, right? Okay. All right. So the language of aging anxiety. Okay. The older I get, the more I worry about my health. Or I don't want to get old. Okay. We hear people say things like this, right? Yeah. What are some examples that you've heard? And how might you respond to them? Yes.
I don't want to get old. Well, you know, it beats the alternative.
It beats the alternative. Yes, that's a great place to start. Absolutely, beats the alternative. It's hard, isn't it? It is, it's hard. Could we say, really? You know, I think, you know, questions are a great way to approach these kinds of things. Because remember, this is fear-based, right? And when a person is afraid, you don't want to respond in a defensive way. You want to respond, and in our department we call this a caring response. I know that sounds like just being nice, but it's not really about just being nice. It's about responding from your professional expertise with compassion, okay? So to ask a person, what does that mean to you, you know?
Yeah. What concerns do you have, or what are some steps you can take to be healthy?
Yes, right? What concerns do you have? How can I help you with that, you know? What steps are you taking, right? To come at it from a questioning standpoint. Now, people frequently do say to me, what do you say? Well, I don't think that that's really the right response. I can't give people, this is the list of what the responses are, right? It's not an SOP of responding to ageism, because we know that ageism is relational, right? It's communicated within the context. You know better the person that you're speaking to, and also you know better yourself. What kind of message is going to be received, right? So it's about coming up within your toolkit, really, right? What are your concerns? Oh, how can I help you with that, right? People don't usually want you to jump into, well, according to Becca Levy, right? Yeah, that really causes people to glaze over. Trust me, I know. Yes, okay.
I do a lot of work in nursing homes. And what I find is these folks, especially that are in a nursing home, they know they're not getting out. They feel they're superfluous. Mm. They have no purpose in life anymore. And that couldn't be further from the truth. Fortunately, most of them are people of faith. And I happen to be also an ordained minister. So I can use that where I need to. And it's very simple. It's more blessed to give than receive. But it didn't say it's not blessed to receive. And so I said, now all of your life you've been giving. Guess what? You've had to find people that needed it to be given to. Now guess what? Your turn now is to be receiving. I know that's difficult for you, but don't tell me you don't have a purpose. And then I go down the line from the nursing home. How I'm going to be able to make car payments because she's there. And then the people who work there can make car payments and pay for the education and all the rest of it. And when I leave, I say, you're right. I really have a purpose. It's just the other side of the coin.
That is a great example. You know, I really like that because it plays into another myth of aging that, you know, we frequently don't want to accept, and that's that. Hey, you know, everybody's got to make a buck, right?
The truck driver that delivered the groceries, I mean, and who made the tie.
Right, all of that. You could go, and I think that's a great way to think about it. You know, historically, culturally, back to this, you know, this notion of our culture and what we live in, you know, and this idea, this myth of independence, you know, we're so focused on what we do and what we produce and what we give to other people, not realizing that that balance is essential. It's essential. That's wonderful. Okay. All right. Internalized language of microaggression. Okay, so we talked about earlier that microaggression is really the those individual assaults that happen quickly that you go, oh, I didn't know what to say, but that hurt. And I'm not sure why it hurt, but it hurt, right? Individual microaggression. That our mind says we're teenagers, but our bodies slow us down. Okay, and I'm going to skip through these last two kind of quickly because I want us to get to the final slide. This one we've kind of talked about already, that I had to show Mom how to use the GPS again. These old people just won't catch on to technology. You know, learning is a motivational issue, right? And people have great motivation to learn things if they're motivated to learn them, if they're things that they want to learn. And while I'm not a believer that people change personality-wise across the lifespan, our goals for things that we're interested in changing. So I just recently got my mother a new iPhone, mainly because I was afraid that her phone was just going to go kaput and she wouldn't have a phone at all, and then we'd have a phone emergency. You know, you remember when nobody had any phones?
Yes.
You remember this? But now it could be a phone emergency. So I got her this new phone. And so we were talking about, you know, things that she could do with her phone, and you know, she said, I just don't, these, you know, other things that people don't really need, calling and texting, maps. Okay, maybe that's it. Okay, so those are the things that she's really most, now she is TED Talks. She has four things that she's interested in on her phone. So all these other things, she's saying, I just don't think I'm ever going to be able to learn these. Right. My mother said this to me. And I said, well, you would be able to learn them if they were things you wanted to learn. Right? She can certainly learn, you know, every new step to every ballroom dance that anyone puts in front of her. Okay, to me, that would be much harder than learning how to use an app. Okay? Learning is a motivational issue, right? People learn what they want to learn. But we have this bias that, oh, I can't learn that. No, maybe you could just say, I don't want to do that. So when my mother doesn't want to do something, she says, you know, I think I'm allergic to that. I love that response. Oh, gosh, yes. I think I'm allergic. There are lots of things I've become. I'm going to become allergic to, like, faculty meetings. Not really. Right? But, you know, there are things that, you know, hopefully you can become allergic to. Okay. All right. Age shaming and age blaming. Now, age shaming happens both at the micro and the macro level. Okay? This is from some research that Jenny Inker and Tracy Gendron and I did about the White House conference on aging, and comments that people had within our professional environment that were clearly ageist. Okay, and these were ones that represented specifically age shaming. You know, my spouse will be upset that I'm saying that she's 65 years old on national television, because people should be ashamed of being 65. Right? Again, old is bad. Okay? Same thing at the macro level in terms of the anti-aging industry. You need all of these products because you should be ashamed of your age. That's grounded in ageism. That's capitalism telling you that you need something that you probably don't need, but their job is to make money based on your fear and anxiety. Period. Right? Period. All right. Other thoughts about age shaming? Okay, all right, and then this, I think this is the last one, is age blaming. Again, at the micro and at the macro level. At the micro level, I'm old, so forgive me because I have to get my glasses to read my notes.
right? I'm blaming my age. Okay, well, you know, presbyopia happens by the age of 40 to most everybody. Lifestyle also has an influence on that. But, you know, blaming your age and saying that's a bad thing rather than that's just a thing, right? Okay, and then silver tsunami at the macro level, and I know I talked about this last year because this is a big concern of mine, that people refer to this blessing of longevity as a silver tsunami, like it's a national crisis. I was watching a TED talk the other day and somebody was saying, you know, that aging is the biggest problem of our century. And I'm like, what? What problem? No, rather than this is the greatest blessing to have elders in our midst and so many of them to help guide the way. Okay. I mentioned this earlier about this is how ageism is transmitted, that it's transmitted relationally. Through our macrocultural narrative, senders and receivers have conversations and we support that. You say, I don't feel as good about myself because I'm older. And a person says, oh, you're not that old, right? Which, or you look great for your age, right? And we're perpetuating, right, those mindsets rather than coming up with a way in here, right there, and disrupting that cycle by saying, really? Right? What does that mean? Right? Or choosing a new doctor. Yeah. All right. Okay. So these are some things that we hear frequently. So, and we can certainly talk about ones that other people have seen, but these are some ones that, you know, I thought we could start with launching points in our last few minutes here together. And what might, if somebody uses these terms, that might be one thing. How would you respond to that? But the other piece is, how might we begin immediately by changing what we call some of these things? These are commonly used phrases. Silver tsunami, we've all heard that. Yes, we've all heard that. Yes? You hadn't heard the older... I love... That's great. I'm thrilled that some people have not heard that. Because I dream about this. It's a nightmare of people saying... Okay, so maybe it's specifically in the aging... Okay, raise your hands if you've heard somebody say silver tsunami. Okay, about half the people have heard somebody say this. I'm sorry I introduced it to you, those who haven't, but it is a dreadful word. It is a dreadful word that, you know, people say that the age wave, you know, the increase in the number of baby boomers and people living longer, they don't call it a wave, which is a naturally occurring thing, in and out, right, waves. They say this is a silver tsunami. Okay, silver tsunami, natural disaster, destructive. Yes, destructive. Okay, that's age blaming. That's saying this is going to be a crisis in our communities and our culture. Okay, I would say that the crisis in our culture is actually about ageism. Right? And the fact that people aren't prepared for either their own aging because of the denial, or they're not prepared for their own aging because our workforce is not prepared. But that's not about the blessing of longevity. That's about our society. Okay, so I'm sorry to the 50% of you who had not heard that word. Now you'll be alerted. Okay. Okay, so what might we refer to as a silver tsunami? If you heard somebody say that again. Opportunity.
Right.
Yes. Do you want to say more about that? No? Okay. I'm good with that. All right. Opportunity. Yeah. Because there are opportunities for individuals as they age, again, to continue to find purpose and meaning, and also for our communities to engage our elders through storytelling and wisdom giving and peacemaking through the concepts of elderhood. Okay, what about when somebody says to you, yes?
Untapped resources. Untapped resources.
Untapped resources.
I mean, yes. In a prior lifetime, I was a marketer, and mm-hmm. if I was looking at and market development, things like that. If you look at that group, there's a whole untapped resource for work, yes. for volunteer, for selling products to, for all these things. It's untapped resources.
Right. Yes, to maintain a sense of purpose. Yes, what were you going to say?
Well, no, I was on to the next one.
Next
Awesome. Let's hear it.
I feel so old. Uh-huh. And you bow.
Right. I'm going to bow. Oh, I love it. I'm going to steal that. Let's bow to your age. Yes, let's bow to your age. I have to say, I remember the first time somebody ever called me ma'am. And I was elated. You know, I was a brand new graduate student. I was teaching at VCU, teaching undergrads. And so I have to say, I went straight through. And so I didn't look much older than my students. And I was so thrilled because it felt like such an elevation that somebody called me ma'am. It was wonderful. I felt it like that. Yeah. Okay. So when somebody says, I feel so old, yeah, bow. How about the rest of you? Other thoughts? When somebody says, I feel so old?
Not me.
Not me? No? You don't feel so old? Like in a good thing? I want to feel old. I want to feel like I have years of accumulation of this great experience and people know that about me, right? Yes, oh, he's telling me. I thought you were gonna say something, Gary. No, you're just telling me 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah?
I'm just the timekeeper.
Oh, man.
Okay. Is that good or bad?
Is that good or bad? Right, because really, based on what we know about the aging experience across the whole lifespan, is that there are good and bad things about all phases. What does that mean to you? Right, what does that mean to you to say I feel so old? Because oftentimes people use old as a shorthand for what they really mean is I feel tired. I feel irrelevant.
I'm in pain,
right? And these are things that you can do something about. You know, oftentimes it's really important, in fact, it's ethically essential to dig into what that means for people. Because equating age with pain or disability or cognitive decline, those are all things that in reality are not about aging. Those are things that are about disease. And so from a diagnostic standpoint, it's essential that we find out what is it that they really mean, because our macrocultural narrative tells us to equate age with disease and disability. Right? So things go undiagnosed because people think, oh, I'm old, I'm supposed to be tired and in pain and sick, and that's not true. That's not true, right? That's why you switch doctors. Okay, purple shirt, you had your hand up.
That's you.
You actually said it. I was going to say exactly the same thing. Are you feeling older? Are you feeling tired? What is, help me understand what old means to you.
Right, help me understand. What does that mean? Yeah, because hopefully the person is saying it to you because they want to do something about it. Sometimes not, right? But at least you've done the best you can in that situation to try to, you know, help move that forward. Okay, what about she looks younger every day? And I think we've kind of talked about that, how, you know, people think that that's a compliment, but in reality it's about, you know, let's embrace all stages of our life. Okay, senior moment. I'm just going to tell you what I say when people say I'm having a senior moment. I say, congratulations. Congratulations. Because there are so many positive things that happen to people as they age, cognitively, in terms of integrative thought and metacognitive processing, emotional regulation. It's just the list goes on. Next year, that's what I'll talk about. Right? Okay. Yes.
The senior group at our church is called Senior Moments.
Is that right? Yes. 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 But they've embraced that as a positive thing, right? I hope. I'm free. When do y'all meet? I will come and talk about why that's a positive thing. Okay. All right, so I hope that you've kind of gotten the point that there are ways to help yourselves and other people reframe the way that we think about our aging experience. And really not even thinking of aging as something that's just happening after midlife. Aging is the whole lifespan. And if we could just think about it in terms of just changing that one word, to not thinking of it as aging, but that really it is all about living. There's a quote that I love from Betty Friedan, and she says that I don't like to think of aging as a lost opportunity, but a new opportunity for strength and growth. So for us to embrace the idea that there are positives of all stages of the lifespan and really to be
discerning and reflective about looking for those positive experiences of late life towards a goal of having a more balanced image of all phases of the lifespan, I think that that would help us all, ourselves internally, and then the interactions that we have with other people. So I thank you for being here today. This was terrific. Thank you for including me for a second year in a row.